the third lecture in our session by Professor Dr. Lamis Ragab. Professor Dr. Lamis Ragab is a renowned professor of pediatric hematology and medical education expert. She is the vice president of New Giza University, and she is the former dean of the Faculty of Medicine, Cairo University. Please, thank you very much, Professor Lamis.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished chair ladies. I would like first to thank Professor Bishlawi and the organizing committee for inviting me. And I don't need an invitation, يعني أنا صاحبة بيت, بس thank you. And I will not talk about, I will take you away from thalassemia and hematology. And we chose the subject, Professor Bishlawi and myself, about education. And I'm going to talk about how global cooperation improves the quality of education and research. And maybe this might be a call for the Arab countries present and the African countries to unite forces, and even the Egyptian universities to get together, because definitely cooperation between universities and institutions improves the quality of education and research. Knowledge has become the primary resource of advanced economies, and education is vital to reducing world poverty and fostering a more equitable and peaceful and sustainable future. And although education has expanded all through the world, the differences between countries is great, and the developed countries or the industrialized world might be decades, if not generations, ahead of some parts of the developing world. And the large difference in opportunities in education between countries is one of the basic causes of global inequality, and some researchers refer to a 100-year gap, a 100-year gap between one country and another. And the cooperation between developed and developing countries is not a new phenomenon. It has been there since ages. It has been through church-related organizations, like the school I grew up in, it was church-related, private organizations, non-profit organizations, and the background was a genuine belief and recognition of education as a key component of self-development and development of the community. And really, the capacity of a new society or a new developing society to educate the new generations is a key component in any national plan or policy. And several attempts have led the participation in education aid for the developing countries, like the Millennium Development Goals, like the UN Global Education Act. And the UN's 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development reaffirms education as a fundamental human right. And its goal number 4 aims to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all by 2030. And also, providing access to quality education is fundamental to achieving other development goals, like including those related to poverty or gender equality or climate action or others. And in the developed world, more than 50% of the age group between 18 and 23 have an access to a place in the higher education. And aim of all the students enrolled in this higher education institutions is to find a well-paid job after graduation. The students, they would like to have success in employment and a fulfilling work, not a safe job like our generation. Our generation wanted just a safe job, but they do want a fulfilling job and a fulfilling life. But unfortunately, this generation is called generation jobless, because in most parts of the world, unemployment is very, very high. And always there is a talk about how to make education more effective to satisfy the job market. neglecting the fact that the main role of education is the intellectual development of the community and not satisfaction of the job market, because well-educated people are job providers, they are not job seekers. They create jobs and they hire other people. But education has changed from a public service driven by professionals to a market-driven service fueled by customers and purchasers. And exactly, especially high education has become an intensely competitive market. And all the students in the world, they look for evidence before applying to a university. And they always look for a world-class university, what they call world-class university. So is it, when we talk with each other, is it a world-class system or a world-class university? And does the world-class university emerge so from Milhawa? A world-class university needs world-class faculty and world-class students. So if you don't have neither a world-class faculty nor world-class students, you won't have ever a world-class university. And all the students, they are trying to acquire knowledge in a globalizing world. And globalization are increasingly affecting the education systems and especially the higher education systems. But let us first agree on some definitions. What is globalization? What is internationalization? And what is cross-border higher education? A globalization, the term defines the global changes that cannot be fended off by national governments. Because when we talk about globalization, it's the effect of the development of world, hybrid world cultures. When you look at the pictures of the young generation, they look all alike. They have traditions and cultures which are common all through the world. And the term globalization disrupts national borders, destroys national structure, and blurs the differences between the nations. And this evolves into the development of a global economic integration so that the world becomes a single market. You can find a McDonald's shop everywhere in the world with the same McFish or McBurger or Mc everywhere. So it's a global market. In education, there is the university ranking system, which depends on things that cannot really measure the quality of education, and the MOOCs, which are the multiple open online courses. But what is internationalization? Internationalization recognizes the national borders and respects the uniqueness of societies and cultures. So when we talk about internationalization in education, it's the introduction of an international dimension into the service, the research, or the function of an educational institution. And this international dimension can be a program, can be a course, can be an activity, can be research, and it respects the individual uniqueness of each organization. So it's between and among nations, and the nation is the basic knowledge. And there is a very nice article in the Chronicle talking about the good, the bad, and the unexpected in internationalization of higher education. But the institutional internationalization has become an embedded and widely accepted part of the higher education sector, and most institutions, they have strategies to develop and manage the international engagement, and you can find even jobs like Vice Provost for International Relations, Dean for International Relations in all the famous institutions of the world. And the education system that cannot keep pace is threatened because everybody seeks to have an international relation, and this is aided by the advances in the information technology. And this also applies to research because research cannot be divorced from high education. They go together like a horse and a carriage. But we have to ask certain questions. What are the models and approaches to international university cooperation today? Under what circumstances are institutional linkages most likely to succeed or fail? What are the strategies involved and what kinds of organizational structure are needed? Because we have to have an organizational structure that suits the cooperation between one institution and the other. But from many, many years ago, we know that science, research, and communities of scholars naturally interact across borders. And Professor Bishlawi can recall that when she just wrote an email to Professor Lucarelli, he answered back the same day, and a cooperation started between Egypt and Italy and resulted in the development of the bone marrow transplantation center. This is a report about the international trends in higher education, 2015, and it talks about the growing popularity of a range of internationalization strategies, and examples are the branch campuses, the international research collaborations, and the cooperation between universities and industry. And this is another report by the British Council describing that most of the nations studied by in this report show policies encouraging internationalization, and the countries rated as most open were Australia, Germany, the UK, and Malaysia, and China. So universities, especially in developing countries, they try to build an international profile, and mostly to develop international recognition of status and programs. And this applies to the new universities which don't have history or don't have a reputational index. And the major motivation is to gain recognition of their programs. The universities, they strike alliance between another to able to compete in the mass market of higher education. And as I said, this is helped by the advancement of information technology, so that the universities now are operating across spatial-temporal boundaries. So what is cross-border higher education? It's the mobility across borders of a teacher, of a student, of a program, of an institution or provider, or a course material. Types of cross-border higher education may be branch campuses, student mobility, joint programs, and the very attractive form of online learning. And the cross-border higher education, it's a very fascinating but very complex phenomena which grows an extraordinary pace using both the virtual and physical modes of delivery, and results in many new opportunities for the students, so that now the students are called global students who seek global education at local costs or at their destination. We can say global education at your reach, where you're sitting, you don't have to travel. And there is always a provider and a receiver country, and the provider country is usually the source of the program or the qualification, and the receiver country is the host of the program or qualification. It can be in many, many forms, like twinning programs, branch campuses, dual degrees, double degrees, validation of an overseas awarding institution, or applying just a pure distance learning mode of delivery. The providing institution can design and deliver the program, or the provider institution can just deliver share delivery, or the provider institution can just the delivery is largely delegated to the partner, to the local partner, and there is only supervision from the provider institution. And there are many approaches, and some countries prefer one approach than the other, so there is a mutual understanding approach, and some countries, they use the skilled migration approach, where they select the students the talented students, or a revenue-generating approach just for making money, or the capacity-building approach. And there are many factors which drive supply and demand. The demand is always there. The students are attracted by an overseas qualification, especially when a good local one is absent, and the attraction of a greater variety of student of programs. And also the students are attracted because the mode of delivery is more flexible than the usual traditional ones. And the provider institution, the people there, they are under pressure to generate money. They are under pressure to deliver in a foreign country because it's en vogue. And it's the desire of the staff for fulfillment and self-advance. The international branch campuses are mainly located in the Gulf area, and China is also famous for international branch campuses. And this is a list of the branch campuses that are present in the Gulf area. When you go down the airport road, you'll find Sorbonne, Abu Dhabi, and Cornell, and very, very famous branch campuses in the Gulf area. But most of them are operating under capacity because of their inability to attract the adequate number of students. So there is always a rising threat for the sustainability of these branch campuses. So they always remain a marginal phenomenon. And in my personal opinion, they are not a true way for development of a society or a country. And in China, they account only for 1% of student enrollment. There are many challenges for these branch campuses, the most important of which is that they need to make a financial return, and also the discrepancies between the students' expectations and perceptions regarding the service quality. And when there is a direct collaboration between two higher education institutions, one from the developed world and one in the developing world, there is always the suspicion of a commercial aim, and sometimes the aid is transformed into trade, a shift from aid to trade. And the worst example is what we call the diploma mills, which offer qualifications at a price, but for little or no study at all. The other type of cooperation is the student mobility, and this has been known since ages and ages. And the student mobility has risen in the last, since 2000, 70% increase to the OECD countries, and mostly Chinese students study abroad, and the UK is on top of the countries which promote international student enrollment. Graduate migration is also very high. And then when we talk about faculty mobility, is also not new. We all know that Theodor Bilharz was present at Asrul Aini Hospital in the 19th century, and he was the one who discovered the Bilharziases and is buried in Cairo. And Cecil Alpert, who discovered the Alpert syndrome, was also a professor at Asrul Aini. So it's not a new phenomena of the faculty mobility. The third thing is the online learning, which is the fastest growing area of international university cooperation. It's very attractive. You'd acquire a degree sitting at home, studying at your pace, and you advance your career, and it's very flexible. And a very interesting example is what we call Universitat 21, which is a global network which started with 16 universities, and the members reached 27 universities in 2019, and they launched an online MBA in 2003. And you can find the names of the participating universities, very famous names in Canada, in China, in New Zealand, in Germany, everywhere in the world. And they have a consortium and providing one online degree to everybody, and the participation is unlimited. And because students, the proof or the evidence the students are attracted to this is that the Open University is the most searched university on Google. These are the top 20 most searched universities. The Open one is the top, is number three by the students. Another example of post-traditional higher education is the massive open online courses. They are massive, they are affordable, they are flexible, they provide unlimited participation, their number is rising, you can see the number, and here is an example of one course provided by Massachusetts, which is a course on circuits and electronics. You can see it's easy to apply, it's easy to register, but the people who continue and pass the exam are less than 5% of the applicants. As I said, research cannot be divorced from higher education, but research is creative, it's original, it does not include the routine investigations. Research is creation of knowledge. And for research to be useful, it should be shared with other researchers and communicated in a suitable format between the users and stakeholders. And at the same time, research is very expensive, and developing countries cannot afford basic research. And there is what we call the 1090 gap, where 10% of the global research funds are devoted to solve 90% of the world's health problems. So there is an imbalance in health research funding known as the 1090 gap, and research is very, very, very expensive. So Egypt is a country with highest ambitions and strong potentials, and the research capacity is not exploited to its full end. But alone, we cannot do a lot, but together with many countries together, or many universities together, even between inside Egypt itself, we can achieve more because we have a high education sector that exists for more than one century. Well, I'll just hint for the hematology of some projects that were very successful in improving the quality of research. We all remember the Ethernet, the electronic infrastructure for thalassemia, the FP6 project, where Professor Bishlawi was the principal investigator, and where then when they wanted to gather the electronic data of 3,000 thalassemic patients from 15 countries, and at that time we had at our center only 2,000 registered thalassemia patients. So our point of strength is the number and mix of patients. With proper filing and proper documentation, we can share in international clinical research. And so was the MedGenet, Euro-Mediterranean Network for Genetic Services. There was another international collaboration on endocarditis. There was another. This was a very interesting project, studying the risk factors for encephalopathy in newborns with severe hyperbilirubinemia. We all know what free thyroxine means, but nobody knows what free bilirubin means. And this was a project studying the free bilirubin funded by the NIH. In the US, you cannot find a newborn with bilirubin of 40. But in no time, 246 patients were recruited with severe hyperbilirubinemia, where they studied the effect of free bilirubin on encephalopathy. Unfortunately, this was in 2010 and 2011, and after the January 2011, the project was supposed to continue, but the reviewers, they stopped the funding because they did not want to fund a turbulent area. Other examples were RAMSES, which was an FP7 project studying the growth of embryonic cells into cardiomyocytes. It was a consortium between Egypt, Germany, and Romania. And we also, everybody here in the podium knows the defriprone evaluation in pediatrics, the DEEP project, which included 15 centers. Three of them were outside Europe, which were Egypt, Albania, and China. And this is a very recent one, funded by the German Research Foundation, studying the genetics of cancer liver. And other examples are transformation partnerships to develop master's degrees between interdisciplinary master's degrees, and this one was a degree in health economics. I'll skip the personal one. And when anybody of you thinks of a cross-border education, you have to know that it is not a shift and lift or a copy and paste or a sell and buy. It's an adopt and adapt, because the worst thing to do for a developing country is to adopt something that is working in a developed country. We have to adapt to our circumstances, and you have to co-create together to develop your own project or program or course, and you use the to counsel and advise from the institution you work with, because capacity building of your staff member is the most important that you can benefit from an advanced institution. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Lamis, for this very comprehensive presentation about this is the promising future, inshallah, for global cooperation and improving the quality of education. And